All right, it's time for another Friday Reads. I'm back in my normal location, back in Boston, and April has been so much better than March. So much better. I'm so excited to tell you what I've been reading. I've already finished two books, and it's very early for me to have finished two books, and I'm on my way in some other ones. So let's first talk about a book that I don't think I'm going to do a standalone review on, because it's like, I don't know, I know I'm going to talk about it a lot in book club, and I don't know, if you guys are interested, I'll do that. But this is Interior Chinatown. This is by Charles Yu. I read it for my local book club. It worked for the Shardathon readathon for a couple prompts, and this was so good. I finished it in a day. A day. And now, granted, it's a screenplay, but it's not all screenplay. There are parts of it that are in prose. I literally just, like, I picked it up in the afternoon when I came home from work, and I just didn't put it down. I just finished it. It was amazing. All right, so the premise of this is satire, literary fiction satire. And it's about this person who is perpetually in this, like, position to be acting as an Asian man in America. And it's about the roles an Asian person gets in America, both in Hollywood, but also, I think, real life. There's a lot of metaphor going on here. It's literary fiction. It's playing around a lot. Like, it plays around so much that it almost feels sci-fi to me. Like, if so, very light. But, like, the blend between reality and, like, fiction and fantasy was very muddled at times because it's a screenplay. Sometimes you're on set. Sometimes you feel like you're in the real world, but how could that be because we're filming for a show? I really liked it. There's a lot that I love that it says. A lot of things that I think are very timely right now, like with all of the Stop Asian Hate movements happening. This, you know, Own Voices talks a lot about what this person feels they want to say about that conversation. Sometimes they refer to court actions that happened in the United States, different laws that were passed specifically to target Asian Americans. And some of them were not undone to like the 40s or 50s. It's insane. It talks about the guilt of not having it as bad as Black Americans, but still having a contentious history in America as being Asian American. This is so good. It has so much to say, and I think it says it in a really palatable way for me. I really like it. I'm really excited to discuss it at book club. I'm so glad I have a copy. I remember I went to get this copy because I was not getting it from the library because the holds list was like forever long and I needed to read it in a timely manner. And I'm like, okay, well, if I don't like it, I'll give it to Ryan or I'll donate it. No, this is mine. This is going on my list of favorite non-SFF books. It's so good. And I've been telling some of my friends that it might be good audio. I don't know. I haven't consumed it audio, but I feel like in some ways you might get more of the satire. In other ways, it might be more confusing. Not only is it a screenplay that's like kind of on set for this kind of classic drama TV show, you also get insight into the family of this character and how that evolves and where they live. And there's so much. And part of why I don't know if I could do a review for this is like, I have a lot of feelings, but I don't have a lot of words other than, I think you should probably try this book. It won an award. See? You should probably read this. But this, like I said, read it in a day. But that wasn't the first book I finished. The first book I finished was Chaos on Catnip. I want to make a little review again, because I made one review on Catfishing on Catnip way, way back, early days of the channel. Well, maybe not early, but it feels early because I'm way better at this whole filming thing now. And the first video, I was more just gushing. And in this one, I want to highlight some tropes and features that maybe, you know, could tell you why this is a young adult series you really need to pick up if these tropes and things work for you. Because I do think that it is a tropey good time, but it also doesn't have tropes that most people associate with young adult. And I think it's really refreshing. I will say, just briefly, I didn't like Chaos on Catnip as much as Catfishing, but it's still got like 4.5 stars. Like, it was still really good. My one complaint is one of my favorite elements just wasn't there enough. There's this Clouder, this online chat group, and it's just, I love that chat group. If you saw in my tag video earlier this week, I love that chat group so much. So those are two things I finished. I am working on Well of Ascension, which I have mentioned in other videos. I'm over halfway. I just finished part three. So you know when you read a book and you know what's gonna happen, but you're just hoping that this time you misremembered it, that it's gonna go a different way. That's what I wanted. It's not what I got. I just finished part three for those who have read the book. It's just like, you get so frustrated. One thing I did notice this time is there's a character who's of a different class system as most of our main characters. You basically are, we have nobles and ska. And ska are the working class and nobles are nobles. Pretty self-explanatory, right? And I think this was more set up like a feudal system, if that's your type of thing to think about. And one of our characters in this series is a noble who really values the ska, wants them to have their own agency. But I noticed this time that things that I really hadn't noticed in the past is that he does kind of make the ska kind of exotic in his head. And he even says that. And it was just something like I noticed. And I'm glad that he thinks about that, that he originally doesn't have a good way of thinking about the ska, even if he is like the most positive rich guy for the ska, you know, it's kind of like, I don't know. He's definitely that woke friend who used to be the weird type of woke, but now he's like actually learning about people. Like he now has like real thoughts. He doesn't have his fake fantastical thoughts towards these people. So I think that's like really interesting. I don't think it's handled exactly how I would want it to be handled if this book came out now, but this book came out in like 2007. So it's kind of different. You know, how we talk about things now is just different, but I don't think it's handled horribly. It's just something, you know, that I noticed reading it now. And I still love that character, like so much. Another book that I started, this big one, Nine of Swords by Brooklyn Quintana, I think. Is so big, is so heavy. It's quality paper. This is a quality arc. They put good money. I am this far, which is about a seventh of the way. I've read 117 pages. Things that I can say about this. Can I even put it here? I don't want to hold it anymore. Okay, so this book, watch it fall on me. No, it should be stable. Okay, so things that I like. It feels very comfortable in a way where, but like, not like something I've read recently. Like I'm reading it and I'm like, oh, I haven't read this type of story in these tropes in a long time. And that excites me. Something else I noticed that there are certain things in this author's writing that I don't know if it's like a debut author thing or if it's, I was talking and reading this with my friend Jocelyn and she was comparing it to like some type of style some people who write fan fiction uses. Sometimes I notice it, sometimes I don't. I noticed it a lot in the prologue and less as I've continued, that there are just sometimes some awkward sentences that I, for myself, have to reread. Granted, that happens in Wheel of Time for me. That happens in Malazan for me. So it doesn't mean that this is badly written. It just means that sometimes there are sentences that my brain is like, come again. So that was a thing. And I don't read fan fiction often, so I don't know if what she was saying is actually what I was referring to, but I think it makes sense. And like I said, that was more primarily the prologue. But let me talk about the tropes that I have apparently missed and haven't read in a long time. We got a solid 12-year-old chosen one with a prophecy and their royalty. I didn't know I missed that, but I did. We have chapters with cool chapter headings. I didn't know I missed that. Like, each chapter has, like, a name to it. Which I know, like, if me and other people, like, sometimes you don't notice the chapter heading. Sometimes you don't notice what number chapter you're on. But these are, like, they remind me of chapter headings in, I feel like the Farseer trilogy had chapter headings. And I don't know, I really like that. What I do find both jarring and cool is it's multiple POV, but not split up in a way like I'm used to with multiple POV. Like, you get to be third person in many people's heads, and that could happen on, like, two pages. Like, you could be in three people's heads within 2 to 3 pages without, like, clear breaks in the line, which is a little jarring for me because I'm just not used to that. It took a little more brain power, but I really like it. I like being in a lot of people's heads. I like seeing it. It's very descriptive. Sometimes the descriptions work really well for me, and it's actually, like, it brings that comfort feeling to me. Like, I can really see this kingdom and, like, the things that are happening. I'm really liking watching Fynneas, our main character, learn things, and it's going to a school setting soon, which I haven't had that trope in a minute. Now, I know I didn't know, and I still don't actually know from, like, the publishers, and if I can find it, I'll put it on the screen, but I can tell you what I think the age range for this book is. It's definitely not middle grade, even though it has a lot of middle grade tropes. For sure not middle grade. This is not targeted to them. Now, I don't think it's also targeted to young adult. I do think this is an adult fantasy, similar to how Assassin's Apprentice, you follow a middle grade aged character. Because I definitely, at least as of now, there's some dark things happening. There are some dark moments. And I think it's just one of those stories that doesn't have, like, a younger target audience, but it could work for that audience. Like, I do think, like, a 12-year-old, as of right now, could pick this up, and the maturity level is okay. But, like, that was something I was curious about when I picked it up, because I did know in the back that it had, like, a school setting, and it had, like, a 12-year-old, and, like, sometimes that's, like, Percy Jackson, right? You never know. But I have missed that. There is a lot of intrigue. I am very curious. I think there's a mentor in this book, too, guys. I haven't had a book with a mentor in a long time, so, yeah. This one, I mean, I have some small complaints about the writing. And if I were to predict my review now, I think it might be a little bit on the long side for the story within the pages. But also, when I sit down to read it, I just feel so cozy. I'm just like, oh, it's so nice to just sink and immerse myself into this new world. And I'm really liking it. Like, it hits the ground kind of running in terms of, like, tension and, like, intrigue and things like that. So that's what I'm reading. And honestly, this and Well of Ascension are what I'm primarily working on. Ideally, I'll have both of those finished, and this time next week, I'm telling you that I'm reading Mad Ship or something. If I feel like I need a smaller break, I think the book's behind me. Yes. Yeah, come here. Come here, book. I might pick up Upright When Wanted because it's short. So if I feel like I need a break between these two huge fantasy epics, I'll pick this one up. But that's all I'm committing to at the moment. That's a lot of pages. That said, I do have A Court of Silver Flames finally on my Kindle, which was not on my TBR. But I've been kind of depressed lately, and when I'm depressed, Sarah J. Maas just knows. She gets me. So I might be picking that up soon. I am having a good day today, but you know, depression, it ebbs, it flows, we move on. And then a couple other things I wanted to tell you guys is, so I'm still doing Shardathon, and the host of it is Sophia from Sophia's Thoughts. Her channel will be down below. She is a very thoughtful book reviewer if you haven't been following her, so you should do that, is really what I'm trying to say. She was one of the first people I started following back when I started my channel. But you guys know I collect books, and that I'm sometimes a little silly about how I collect books. And last year I bought The Killing Moon and The Shadowed Sun because I love that duology review in the cards. And unfortunately, I bought the American copy of The Killing Moon and accidentally the UK copy of The Shadowed Sun, which means they are different sizes. Because what is size uniformity? And I thought about buying the UK version of The Killing Moon. I thought about buying the American version of Shadowed Sun, but Ryan was judging me. And so Sophia asked for our Amazon wish list, which I don't usually have one because I don't like to have too many things and it stresses me out. So I don't, that's the reason why it's never in my descriptions. I just don't have one because it stresses me out. But she wanted a wish list. So I like made sure there were a few books on my Amazon wish list. And one of them, I put The Shadowed Sun. And so now it's the same size and it makes me so happy. I also love this book. And this, like most American editions, is a little floppier. So when I do get to reread this amazing duology, I'm gonna be very excited. Also, Evie, finally, the book came, The Poison Song. So now I have the third book in a trilogy that I really hope I like at this point. I have all three of them. I haven't read a word of it. But I don't know, everything Elliot says makes me really intrigued. It makes me feel like it's my type of fantasy. So I'm really hoping. But that's this video. I filmed this with a new microphone, so I hope it sounds good. You know, it is what it is. I'm pretty excited about it because, in theory, it's directional. And that, from what my brain has read on the internet, that means you are less likely to hear the people on my street, which really excites me. I know this is kind of like behind the scenes, no one really cares, but I am extremely excited about that. So what are you reading this weekend? Are you doing well on your readathons? Is this a better or worse month than March for you? It's way better than March for me so far. I have a 4.5 and a 5 star already. Last month I didn't break 4, so I'm really excited. And otherwise, if you want to leave an emoji, leave like a flame emoji. I won't tell you why, but like this like kind of looks like fire. So I want fire. So like a flame emoji, please. And like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye.